Insan is based on two things, the zahir, the apparent, and the batin, the hidden, the internal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has linked the two together, and they have a very deep link and connection with each other, the zahir and the batin. And the batin, the inner state, is such there are two parts to the batin as well. So the batin, the inner state, the life of the inside, the spiritual life, has two components. One component is illustrious and has nur and light, and the other component has darkness. Darkness and oppression, dhulm. So if we look at these two things, what we see is that zahir is apparent, it is visible, our external life, and the batin is the internal, the hidden, the spiritual life. And the situation around the batin, the internal life, the internal state of affairs, is that when we depart from this world, then the zahir will become hidden and the batin will become apparent. So here in the dunya, in the world, the zahir is apparent, our body, our external self, our physical actions. And the batin, the spiritual self, the inner state, which is more essential and critical, is hidden. But when we die and depart, the batin will be apparent and the zahir will become hidden. And the more in this world we enlighten and illuminate and purify our batin, our inner state, the more that in the hereafter we will be successful. The more in this world, the hidden state, which is our inner self, our spiritual state, if it is beautiful and purified and clean and pure and nice, then all of the phases after death, the challenges and the journey that we have to go through, all of those challenges and the journey will become successful. Because the nur and the light and the purification in our batin we make today, all the challenges afterwards will come in the darkness. There's no electricity there. There's no light there. And that preparation that we have made in the dunya, in this world, it will give the light for us in the hereafter. Because we cannot prepare to create energy in the hereafter. The energy has to be created here. So the more we illuminate, purify and fill our batin with nur in this world, the more we will get light, illumination and ease in the hereafter, in the phases of the grave, in the darkness of the grave, on the day of Hashar, resurrection, on the day of judgment, on the journey across the bridge of Sirat. How will we pass these phases in the journey of the hereafter, in the darkness, if we don't have the light to assist us? So the more we illuminate our batin, our inner state in ruh and spiritual state in this world, we will get benefit and light in the hereafter. And if we have darkness and rust and dirt and diseases in our batin, in this world, then we will struggle in the hereafter. We will be burnt, we will be in darkness, we will be thrown into the burnt, charred places, into the depths of Jahannam and Hellfire. So, the success in the hereafter, the success in the hereafter, will be based on the illumination and the purification of our batin in this world, in this life. So obviously, at this moment in time, we have both things. We have dahir, our external life, and our batin, our internal life. And Allah Ta'ala has arranged for the purification and the betterment and enhancement and illumination of our batin, inner state in this world. Allah says, if you want to strengthen your hereafter, do it while you're living in this world. And the generator is called A'mal. The generator which will create the benefits and hereafter are in this world. So the generator is called A'mal. You have A'mal al-Salihat, the good deeds, and you have A'mal of sins, the bad deeds. So you have the generator, the good generator that creates nur within you. Yes, it gives you the capacity to do good deeds. And that won't come in the grave, will it? As I said, you have to prepare for your energy and light in the hereafter from this world. When you die, if you've created a hoard of good deeds, you've created a multiple of good deeds, a battery of good deeds, a collection of good deeds through the generator of A'mal, then you will get the reward in the hereafter. So one is the A'mal, the deeds, A'mal us-salihat, the good, pious deeds, upright deeds that will give us reward in the hereafter. And then there are the negative deeds that won't give us reward in the hereafter. So how do we create amalu salihat in our life? How do we do lots of and high quantity and good quality amalu salihat, good deeds in our life? How do we create that basis or that condition? That definition is that those deeds that are within the boundary of Sharia and the way of the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, within that boundary and circle, and if you implement that deen, those deeds that are based on these two points, the Sharia and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the nur will increase in your heart, in your batin. You can't see it, it's hidden. Allah Ta'ala said that the batin, the light of the batin, is hidden in the world, but in the hereafter it will become apparent. Just like, for example, you read a hadith, you read verses of Quran, that people's faces and thereafter will be shining like the moon on the 14th night. Somebody will rise from the grave with the face shining, forehead shining, limb shining. What will be that light that will be shining? It will be the light of the batin in this world that will then transform to our body in the grave and the hereafter, and it will become apparent. Here you don't know. You can't see. You're doing good deeds and the light is burning inside you, intensifying inside you. Like the hadith I tell you, this is a gathering of dhikr, it's linked to this gathering, that on the day of resurrection, when there will be a group of people, a jamaat, an assembly of people, a group of people who will be sitting on beautiful thrones and seats full of yaqut and jewels and pearls and expensive stones. And on the day of Hashr, they will be sitting, this group of people, on those thrones. And their faces will be glowing like the moon on the 14th night. What nur is that? What light will that be? It's the nur that they developed in their batin, in their inner state, in the world, that Allah Ta'ala then transfers to their limbs and bodies and faces in the hereafter. So here people are looking at your bodies, and people are they are impressed by big bodies, big biceps, and bodybuilders, and who do exercise, and they make the body toned and beautiful, and the exterior apparent self, the dahir, is made beautiful. So here, in this world, the batin is hidden. So when you're doing good deeds, and you're purifying your batin, and you're doing good deeds, and you're purifying your batin, and increasing the light and nur of Islam and Iman in your heart, yes, it can't be seen, but in hereafter, that nur will start to help you as soon as you die, in your grave, day of resurrection, and the hereafter. But Allah Ta'ala says that it will assist you through the phases of the hereafter. May Allah Ta'ala enhance and intensify, strengthen our nur in this world, in our batin. So these people will be sitting on the thrones, and their faces will be shining like the moon on the 14th night. And people on the day of resurrection, judgment, will ask Allah, who are these people? What deeds did they do in the world that today they're sitting on the thrones and they've got such great nur and light on their faces and bodies? They're not prophets. They're not shuhada. They're not the martyrs. And they're not people who have got the link with the Sahaba. But what deed did they do that was so strong and great that today the whole of mankind on the Day of Judgment is looking at the nur on their faces and bodies? So obviously they worked hard and strived in the world. And Allah Ta'ala said they created the nur in their batin, in their hearts. And that nur was preserved and it took them to the hereafter. And they will say, Allah, who are these people? Allah will say, this is that jamaat, those people, that group of people who used to get together in a certain place in certain days. There were different people from different backgrounds, different generations. They used to come from different countries, different families, different dialects, different languages, etc. They used to gather in one place. And obviously that place where Muslims get together is the masjid. Allah says, they used to get together in my house. And they used to do one deed. They used to practice one deed. What was that? The dhikr of Allah. The dhikr of Allah. And Allah Ta'ala is the one who collects, gathers us, assembles us. Who brought us here? Who invited us here? Allah Ta'ala's fadl and His blessings that He has made us sit here. And Allah Ta'ala says that His amal of dhikr created such a nur in the world while He lived, that was preserved in His heart. That nur continued along His life till death. And in the hereafter, the whole of mankind will see that nur, when those people who are the dhakirin will be sitting on the thrones, with the faces shining like the moon on the 14th night. Other deeds have light: fasting, hajj, zakat, coming to the masjid to pray salah, reciting Quran. Are these the only deeds that will create light and nur in our batin? No. Allah Ta'ala said for the mu'min, every deed of a believer has the potential to create nur and light in his heart. And how? If you do every deed in your life according to the sunnah, that will develop nur in your heart. And if you do a deed against the sunnah, it will create darkness in your heart. So this is not the case that you just come to the masjid and you'll get nur, or you pray salah in congregation, you'll get nur, light in your batin. No, every action, eating, drinking, standing, sitting, sleeping, going to the toilet, out to the toilet, putting your shoes on, taking your shoes off, wearing your clothes, taking your clothes off, going to your wife, sitting, speaking with the children, running your business, transactions, living in society, social intercourse, interaction, morning till night, whichever actions you do, A to Z, Allah Ta'ala has had mercy on this ummah, that if you imitate my Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, every action of yours, your body, your heart, batin, will be filled with the noor. So how much noor can you create in this life, I ask you? If you do every action in your life according to sunnah, your whole body, internally, externally, will be full of noor. So Allah Ta'ala has mercy on this ummah, that noor and light you will not just earn for your batin in the masjids, on tawaf around the Kaaba, or doing salah, praying, reading Quran, whether you're in any country in the world, west to east, north to south, Africa, Turkey, or Pakistan, or Europe, or the western hemisphere. If you live your life in every corner of the world by imitating Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you will develop light and noor in your heart. How did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam do this? I want to do this. What was his actions like? What were his actions like? What did he say? What did he do? We continue to listen, implement, imitate the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Noor will come to our life. We eat, the food goes in our stomach, the stomach is expanding, we're eating chickens, we're drinking water, and we're drinking mashroob and nice drinks, and our stomach is being filled, and we're feeling the taste. We are enjoying the world. At the same time, if we do it according to the sunnah, then you'll get the noor and the light of the akhirah at the same time, free of charge. What a great life of a mu'min. But we waste it. We waste it. Be careful. Insan should be careful. Be cautious a little bit in his life. Am I doing this according to the right way? Is this the way of the, within the boundary of the sunnah? And you will develop noor in your batin and your heart in this world and thereafter. How? If I switch the light off now, will we be in difficulty? Of course we will be. What do we do in the darkness? We can't read Quran. We can't prostrate. We don't know where the lines are. Where should we line up? Pray salah. We'll run to try to put the light switch on. If we haven't got light, if the electricity has been cut, we'll buy candles and put the light on, because we need light to give us guidance, direction in the hereafter. We'll be severely, severely in need of light for guidance to take us through the journey to the hereafter, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how do we do that? How will we get the light? Either we burn our lives in this world, or we enlighten our lives in this world. If we do the right deeds, the good deeds, we will have good light intensity of noor in the hereafter. If we do sins and bad deeds in this world, then we'll get darkness in the hereafter. So every single deed, every second of the life of the human being has the potential to give him light to live through this life and to guide him in the hereafter. So in life, every function, every environment, every society, every party, every gathering, these are all coming to our lives. They will come. Somebody gets married, everybody gets married, so the marriage will come, and that will come, and there will be wedding functions, and the cards will be printed. Now, do you want to make your wedding full of noor and light, or do you want to make it full of darkness? If that wedding that everyone's going to get married in life, and the person who doesn't get married, may Allah Ta'ala allow him to get married, such a big function, you get invited to the function, the wedding, to the function, the wedding function, the walima, or the nikah, whatever, and you arrange that wedding party function, celebration according to the sunnah, or if you don't, you do it according to the sins. Because if a person sins for a few seconds, he thinks he's enjoying himself. For example, scratching on your wound. When you start scratching the wound, you feel nice sensation. But as you keep on scratching, then the pain comes and the blood comes out of the wound. So in the world, when you think you're opposing the deen and the sunnah, you think there's enjoyment and happiness and laughter, and you're having a laugh. And the sins, when you start sinning in the world, you see the enjoyment, you think so-called enjoyment. But when you keep on sinning, then the wound breaks open, the blood comes out, and you feel the pain of the sins. So we are here in this gathering, are sitting and up, getting up and sitting down and living in life. We have to live in society. We have to practice the different journeys and phases of life. So if we're not careful in our life, and if we don't live our life in accordance with the sunnah in every step, in every phase, in every journey, in every step that comes our way, then our life will be filled with the darkness. Allah says, وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا فَاهِشَةً لَا تَقْرِبُوا فَاهِشَةً. Allah Ta'ala has not told us to do zina. Allah says, وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا الزِّنَا وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا فَاهِشَةً وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا زِنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاهِشَةً. Allah said, didn't just say, don't do zina, don't do fahisha, don't do these sins. Allah said, don't go near to those deeds that have the capacity of giving you darkness in your batin. Doesn't matter how many restrictions there are, hurdles there are, obstacles there are, you get invited to darkness, say, brother, I don't want to diminish my noor in the hereafter, because if I go to the darkness in the hereafter, then just like noor is different, every amal is elevated due to the deeds of the sunnah, in the same way the sins of darkness have different levels and grades. There are such levels of sin that when a person sins, He creates darkness and the blot of darkness in his heart, and certain sins, the punishment of such sins are, you cannot eliminate those sins and the punishments in this world. They're so solid and ingrained in the heart, the only way to eliminate them is by being burnt in the hellfire. That's why our Naqshband Salaf pious predecessors have taught us that rather than emphasizing and doing good deeds, if you can't do that, then at least spend all your time on not doing the sins. If you can't do good deeds, if you don't have the energy, you don't have the power, you can't dare to do good deeds, but then definitely do one thing in your life, that don't go near to the sins. Don't burn your deeds. Don't burn your wujud. Don't burn your batin. Try your best in your life to do this. Okay, you can't pray tahajjud. You can't pray voluntary salah. You can't recite the Quran as much as you want to. Okay, no problem. It's not critical. End of the world. But if you do, then you will instill nur into your life and the hereafter. But at least minimum, don't commit the sins in life. Because sinning is such a dangerous action that if you sin, then you are burning your whole batin, your whole inner state. And if you, may Allah not let this be, that you sin in such a way, you have such bad company, or you go to such a place in the world in your life and you commit such a sin that the darkness of that sin is so severe that it blots onto your heart, and that sin takes you into hellfire to be burnt to cleanse that sin, then we'll be in a bad position. Imam Mujaddad al-Thani rahmatullahi, who was one of the great sheikh from the family of Naqshband teachers who lived in Sarhan Sharif in India, he was imam. He was the sheikh of his time, the Mujaddad of his time, the reviver of the deen of his time. Agreed. And as the tariqah, when there is difficulty in the time and a person, his time comes to near an end, he's about to die, and people try that, call a pious person, a wali of Allah, let's do dua, let's read something, so the pain at the time of death decreases. And this is sunnah. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go and visit people at the time of their death and used to do dua for them and pray for them and ask for ease for them. So at that time, Hazrat Mujaddad al-Thani rahmatullahi was alive and present, and there was a person who he knew was about to die, close to death, and somebody came to Hazrat Mujaddad al-Thani, that somebody you know is about to die, please go and see him, give your tawajjuh, give your attention and focus. This is a way of doing dua, where a sheikh does tawajjuh, focuses and gives his attention. So Hazrat Mujaddad al-Thani rahmatullahi went to that pine who was dying and gave tawajjuh to him, focused on him and did dua for him. And because his heart was clean and he could feel that, is this benefiting this dying person or not? And when he did tawajjuh, Hazrat Mujaddad al-Thani rahmatullahi, his tawajjuh, his focus and attention was strong. The more tawajjuh he was giving, it was rebounding and coming back from the dying person to Hazrat Mujaddad al-Thani. It was not penetrating him, it was not benefiting him. His batin was full of darkness, and his bath in his heart could not absorb the tawajjuh of Hazrat Mujaddad al-Thani, and he was getting distressed that until today I have not seen this, that wherever I've had an opportunity, I've done dua and given tawajjuh for somebody, his situation has dramatically changed and tawbah has been accepted. The wise, has he got so much darkness in him, this brother, that his situation is not turning even before death? He's not being accepted his tawbah. So my friends, we need to think, have I done a big sin? But sometimes Allah Ta'ala has his own hikmah, wisdom. Sometimes it happens that there's a person who's doing zina, he's committing adultery, and compared to him there's one person who he's just broken the heart of person. We say just, but it's not a small sin. Allah says, no, I don't want this person who committed that sin of breaking the heart, and I'll forgive this person who did zina. So don't take sins upon your standard. Rather take a sin on the standard of Allah. And understand that whenever you are sinning, there's no such thing as a small sin or a big sin. Don't say, oh, it's a small sin, I pray salah, I'm pious, I did dhikr in the morning, dhikr in the evening, I did this and that. And then you go and sit in a gathering and you think you're forgiven. What will happen? Allahu Akbar. All of your batin will become dark. This is a big loss of the hereafter. A big loss of the hereafter, where a person lives in deception. I've got deeds, I'm pious. Apparently, outwardly, I've got Islamic attire, I'm a Naqshbandi, a Qadri, a Chishti, I do dhikr, and I do this much ibadah, this much Quran, and I've given so much sadaqat and charity. Doesn't matter, this much list, this is not going to do nothing for me, this makes no difference to me. Oh, this is insignificant. Okay, and you know, I am pious and people know I pray and I'm observant, etc. But he should know that don't count your deeds. Inside you, your pride of your deeds will waste away and burn your deeds. It will waste away all of the striving and struggling you've done, and your batin will be crushed and darkness will be in your batin, and you may not even get the chance to come back. People have dropped from big, big maqams. MashaAllah, brothers, you do dhikr, you are the dhakirin. That's why I'm telling you. That's why in the circles of the tasawwuf and our pious predecessors, they say the first step is to abstain from sinning. Doesn't matter how much of a sacrifice you have to give, don't go towards the sins. Don't go towards that gathering where there's a amal, a deed that's against Sharia. Go away from it. Run away from it. Doesn't matter what people say. Take the swears and the ridiculing and the jesting and the sneering of this world, and you'll save yourself from the snares of the hereafter. So Hazrat Mujaddid al-Aftani was given tawajjuh, praying for that dying person, but the darkness in his heart was not diminishing, was not decreasing. Then Hazrat Mujaddid al-Aftani did dua and thought to Allah, but Allah Ta'ala gave the ilham, inspiration, the mujaddad, you can do as much tawajjuh as you want, but his sins are so bad, your tawajjuh will not work, his darkness will only be eliminated in one place, and that is the fire of Jahannam. Tell me, how severe is this situation, that we need to be very careful. Don't go to a gathering of people, don't go to a function, don't go to a party, don't go to a gathering or an assembly where there are actions against Islam and the Sunnah. Because if you go to such a place or sit with people or spend time with people in opposition to the Sunnah and Islam, then you will make your batin dark. At the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Rasulullah sallam led the salah, did salam, finished the salah, and said that somebody in the gathering, it seems to me, it feels to me that somebody's wudu was not correct, because the effects of his incomplete wudu came into my salah, into my leading of the salah. Himself, Rasulullah ﷺ is leading the salah, and he said after the salah ﷺ, that I felt after the salah, I felt that the wudu of somebody is not complete in a gathering. And what does this show? That certain sins become such, and the body becomes dark, the heart becomes dark, that the darkness doesn't just give the negativity to that person, rather all the people around him also get the ill fortune, the misfortune of his darkness and sinning. So those people, especially people may call you pious, or me pious, or good people, oh he looks like a good Muslim. I'm trying to say something here, it may sound severe, you got tasbihs and rosary beads and you do dhikr, that's fine, but think for a second that alongside your external beads, have you got the noor and the light in your batin, or are you earning darkness in and darkness and burning in your batin? If a person is doing all good deeds externally, ibadah, but he goes to a gathering where he's invited, where there are actions being carried out which are against the deen, then that sin of attending that function, the gathering, will increase so much that he himself will first be committing a sin, and his life and heart will be full of darkness. And after that, his action will give power and encouragement to the people who are sinning. Oh, this person's come to a gathering, he does dhikr, he's this person, and based on his attendance and his guidance, they say, it doesn't matter, he did this sin, and he came to this gathering, such a pious person who practices Islam, in the name of Islam, and he came to our sinful gathering, so that means we can do this as well. No, he does dhikr, he's an imam, or he's pious, and he's practicing, externally he's practicing, and he did this action, this sin, so why don't we do this sin? So the darkness of this sin will come into his heart first, and then it will be transferred to the hearts of the other people. One insan who commits the sin, so-called pious person, he became himself involved in the sin of other people in their gathering, their illegal gathering, against the Islamic ethos. So first the darkness will come to his heart, then the darkness of his sin will go into the hearts of the other people, and due to the disrespect that he created to the deen of Islam, due to his bad action, think, listen to what I'm saying. For example, if a person's son does a bad action, then who do the people backbite against? They say, oh, his son, the son of this person, he stole, the son of this person, he did this action. And when the murid of a sheikh does a sin, then who does the information come back to? Who does the feedback come back to? To the sheikh. So when a student, when a Muslim practicing person does a bad action, then he has double standards. He has two consequences of deeds. One is he commits the sin and earns the sin himself. And secondly, he is doing publicity that this is acceptable in deen. And thirdly, if he is a teacher, a guide, then all the people who see that student, who's meant to be pious and upright and good practicing, then they will say that he is the student of this sheikh, and this is fed back to that person. Of course he is the student of the sheikh, and this is acceptable, and the bad feedback comes to that sheikh. So the sin is first in his heart, the sin is transferred to the other people who do that sin, and the bad feedback comes to the teacher of that person. My friends, as I said, a sin is not restricted, rather it increases and spreads across the generation. So if you do good deeds, then you get good light in your heart, and you spread that light across the world and your life and thereafter. But if you do bad actions, you will get the sin, you will get the punishment, other people get encouragement due to your sinning, and say, yeah, we can do these sins. sins, these good so-called practicing Muslims are sinning, we can practice, and you are also disrespecting your sheikh, even your sheikh gets a bad name. Allah says, وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا زُنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَحِشًا وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا فَحِشًا. When you get invited to bad places, bad gatherings, bad society, bad environment, stay far from that. I've done dhikr, I've enlightened my heart, I've spent my life in hardship and struggle and striving. May it not be that due to the wretchedness of this bad gathering that I'm invited to, if I go there, or even if I'm invited, I go there myself, then straight away the darkness will come. All his deeds turn to waste, all the nur in his heart turns to waste, all his dhikr turns to waste, his maqam comes down low, his status drops, Allah Ta'ala puts his name in this list of the sinful people, then how will he strive again, work hard again? Allah Ta'ala give him a chance before that. What do you know about your life that you'll get a chance again? Tasbihat you did dhikr, you struggled, you strived, you recited Quran, you went to tabligh, you went to good gatherings, you recited naats, you recited durood sharif, you listened to naats, you listened to durood, you sat in good deeds, you had du'as of the pious predecessors, pious people around you, your sheikh. Will you get the chance again? You won't. Such a great deed. Allah Ta'ala has given us a chance to do good amal, good deeds. Protect your deeds. Preserve your deeds. Even if you get a big loss in the world due to not attending the sinful gathering or to do a sin, don't worry. Persevere. Because a sin takes a few seconds but has disastrous long-term consequences. Be it your close relatives who invite you to sin, they are in the form of shaitan, they're giving you invitation to go towards sin. Never obey or implement a sin. Doesn't matter how close, your mother, father, uncle, grandfather, never can they invite you to sin, or shouldn't, they shouldn't, but never accept the invitation to sin. Otherwise you will earn big losses in this world and hereafter. May Allah Ta'ala give us the tawfiq, the ability to do good deeds, to do deeds full of light, and every action, may Allah Ta'ala allow us to develop a fikr, a worry, that we keep enlightening our heart. What's the method for that? This whole life is amal. And how do we create nur and enlighten nur? By following the sunnah of Rasulullah in life. When you leave this gathering, stop. How do I put the shoes on? Do I put the shoes first in the right foot, then on the left foot? This is sunnah. Straight away the nur will come into your life. Straight away, you go home in the style of the sunnah, read the dua, open the door with the dua, say salam to everybody, beautiful nur will come into your heart and your life, your house. You go home, just like you go home, you do wudu, if you don't have the tawfiq, do tayammum and do miswak. In any condition, do miswak, go to your bed in the night. After that, you should know the tariqah, the method, sleep on the right side and read the dua masura, read the duas of Rasulullah, Allahumma bismika amut wahiya, and put your right hand under your face. And all night long, you'll get the nur and the light. So you're sleeping, this protection of your iman in the same way, eating, drinking, standing, sitting, journeying, traveling. Should you not do the follow the sunnah? This is deen. We think this is not deen. Learn this, how to do miswak, how to follow the sunnah, how to wear the surma, kalirim, and eyes, how to prepare for jummah, which clothes we should put on. Some people have said that this is daif, but this is the practice of the pious predecessors, and this is mustamir. Practice that. Subhanallah. And this hadith has been recited in a certain collection. Some people say it's daif, some people say sahih. But this rawaya, these narrations have reached to us. And due to this barakah, even if it's daif, say, Allah, we want to imitate your Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, please give us the sunnah reward. So increase your amal, increase your deeds, and make your deeds full of nur. You're praying salah, and salah, make your salah full of nur, full of light. The more you implement actions with that, and the way of the sunnah, try in your life to implement the life according to the sunnah, and make this a means for earning. Don't just think that you're here for nothing. Sunnah is not, oh, if I do it, fine, if I don't, know. This is so valuable, my friends. It's the massive treasure. We only have a few breaths. You are here, you're sitting here. After a while, what will you do? You'll do a bit of dhikr of Allah. You've utilized your time for a few time, for a few seconds or moments or an hour. This 1 hour. How many people out there have wasted this hour? Worldly talk, this, backbiting, slandering, business talking, houses, assets. In 1 hour, so much loss a person can earn, tell me. And in that hour, what have you earned? Tell me, what have you earned by being here? Who should we be grateful to? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how do you protect your deen, your deeds? That don't go near the sins. No brother, no sister, no relative, I can't do the sins. This invitation you give me to is against sunnah, against the sharia, I can't come here. You can practice this, but I can't come. No, I'm sorry, I am forced to implement the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may be my relatives, because there will come a day, your relatives, your mother, your father will not help you on the day of judgment. Please, I beg you, leave me to my being and my life. Let me live my life in good deeds. Don't take me to the sin. Don't invite me to sin. May Allah Ta'ala give us the tawfiq. Ameen. Recite Durood Sharif.